מסכת פסחים, דף עין ה, and we're going to be discussing the definition of fire, really, because the Korban Pesach has to be roasted, sili esh. So, fine, directly on the fire is good, but what if it's in some way indirect, like if it's on a griddle versus a grill, or something that's heated from fire, like the wall of an oven. So the heat came from fire, but now something is being cooked on that. Is that also defined as fire? Or how about the coals themselves, right? So if it is directly on the coals, so it's getting heated from the heat of the coals rather than from fire, is that also considered fire? So we're gonna compare the Korban Pesach to other places where fire is mentioned, including Sadat with regarding Yom Kippur and other places, and that way we'll be able to define it better. All right, so the Mishnah mentioned that you cannot roast on a grill, right? It has to be on a spit. The animal cannot be resting on a grill. But then the Mishnah said a story that Rabban Gamliel told his servant Tavi, go and put and roast my Korban Pesach on a grill. And so this seems to be a story that contradicts the halacha you just said. You just said it's not allowed, but then Rabban Gamliel does it. So question, ma'aseh listor, right? Why are you bringing a story to disprove, to be the opposite of the halacha you just said? You should bring a story to show that the halacha, he did the halacha, not that he didn't do the halacha. So we answer, chasore mechasera v'hachi ketaneh, must be that the Mishnah is missing some words. You have to understand that you have to include these words. And at the end of the Mishnah, it said, "V'im askela minukevet mutar." You're right. If it's a griddle that is whole, you know, kind of like the way we make pancakes on, then that's a problem because it's not, the fire is not going directly onto the food. But if it's a perforated grill and the fire comes through, then it's permitted. And then we have the story. And so that story was regarding a perforated grill. So there you go, perforated grill is in fact permitted according to the story. And then we read that back into the Mishnah as well. Okay, this is different from the way I interpreted it yesterday. Yesterday I said that Rabban Gamliel is actually doing his own opinion different from the Mishnah. And according to the majority opinion, even a perforated grill would be prohibited. But the Gemara doesn't like my explanation. I think mine is the Peshat, but anyway, the Gemara would prefer to bring the halacha in line with Rabban Gamliel's story. All right, and now we get to the next question. Ba'amine Rav Chinena bar Idi merav Ada bar Ahava. Tanur shesiko beklipe orla, ugrafo ve'afa bo et hapat. Lidibre ha'oser mahu, amar le hapat muteret. Okay, so we're going back to a case that we saw way back around Daf Chaf regarding orlah. Orlah is asur bahana. You're not allowed to benefit. You're not allowed to eat orlah, fruit that grows in the first 3 years. And you're not allowed to even benefit from it. So over there, we discussed the case. What if you used orlah not as food, but as fuel? And so you put it in the oven to burn, and you made bread, you baked bread in that oven. What is the status of that bread? Does the benefit of the orlah, which is prohibited, does that enter into the bread and make the bread not kosher? Or is it just you violated because you benefited, but it doesn't go into the bread, the bread itself, one can eat? So that's what we discussed there. And now we're asking, according to the one who says that in that case it's prohibited, what about if I heated up the oven with orlah, but then I took out all of the orlah, I took out all of the fuel, all of the ashes, and now there's only residual heat on the walls of the oven. And then, only then, I put the dough onto the walls of the oven and it bakes from the residual heat. What about that case? And so the answer is amaleh pat muteret, that is fine because that's totally indirect. It's not benefiting directly from the orlah. Okay, why are we bringing this here? Because of the following. We have a contradiction from this statement of Rabbi Yochanan that relates to Korban Pesach. Tanur she'siko ugrafo v'salabo et pesach en ze sili esh. I heated up an oven And then I took out all the fire and all the ashes, and then I put the Korban Pesach in, and it roasted just from the residual heat in the walls of the oven. Is that considered Sili Esh? This answer is no. Shene'emar Sili Esh Shete Pa'amim. Only because it says it twice in the Pasuk has to be Sili Esh. Now that means if it only said Sili Esh one time, I would say has to be roasted in fire. But in that case, I might say any kind of fire, you know, even if it's direct or indirect. So therefore, the second Sili Esh says that even indirect fire would not be good. Well, now it's not called fire. Now, the only reason why it's prohibited in this case of Pesach is because it says it twice. But if not, if it only said it one time, then I would have said that burning something in residual heat, cooking something in residual heat, would be in fact considered fire. It's only because it says twice here. I'm trying to imagine, like, you know, Moshe telling Bnei Israel, make sure to roast the Pesach, Sili Esh, and they're all saying, oh, so if we just heat up the oven with fire and then put it in after, it's okay? He says, no, Sili Esh, I really mean it, right? So in that case, he had to say it twice. But otherwise, in other cases, in this residual heat may be okay. And so therefore, if we apply that back to the case of orlah, now it's the case of orlah, if residual heat is considered in fact fire, then that bread should be prohibited, right? See, what's that which is a kula in regarding Pesach is a chumrah regarding orlah, because orlah, we don't want it to be fire. Because we don't want to benefit from the heat that was derived from the orlah. So according to this, although it's true, you can't use this residual heat for Pesach, that's only because it says it twice. If it had said it once, then it would be allowed. And regarding orlah, it does not say anything at all. So the general definition of fire would include residual heat is fire, and therefore this bread should be not allowed, and you said it's allowed. That's the question. We're gonna have two answers. Amar le galera chamana hatam bialfinan mineh mina. Oh, so why don't you just say that Pesach is not the exception, but rather that's the rule, right? The Torah says regarding Pesach twice in order to teach you that in this case and in all cases throughout the Torah, if you just say fire, residual heat is in fact fire. But if you say it twice, then that means it has to be fire itself and not residual heat. And so from that we can learn that regarding orlah, it's not considered heat, and therefore it would be permitted. The orlah would be permitted. So that's the first answer. So Pesach is a precedent, all right? So in both cases, it's not. And then we're going to see a second answer that orlah uses prohibited wood. That's the problem. But in general, the answer to the first question is that material heated from fire considered fire itself. In general, we're going to say yes. So let's see how we answer it that way. Regarding Pesach, the reason why that I can't use residual heat is because it says it twice. But if it didn't say it twice, if it just said esh once, then I would say, oh yeah, it has to be something that's from fire. But even if it's residual heat in the heat in the walls of the oven after I cleaned it out, that would still be fire. But here, regarding orlah, we have a different problem, which is that the branches themselves were actual orlah, and that was prohibited fuel altogether. And so that's why that the orlah would be a problem, even though in general the definition of fire would in fact include residual heat. Just not for Pesach, because there it says it twice. All right, so that's that concludes that discussion. And now the rest of the daf will be a discussion of Rabbi Yehuda Anasi. He made a ruling that if you put the Korban Pesach directly on the coals, not on the spit that's spinning around above the fire, but directly on the wood that you're burning. When we say coals here, it doesn't mean coals like that we think of digging out of the ground that we mine, but rather it means hot logs. So if you put it directly, that is called roasting. We're going to see that one contradiction from Sadat, another contradiction from Yom Kippur, and within the contradiction from Sadat, we're going to try to answer it based on wood coals are fire, or from Mikvah. Okay, let's see the details. Tenor banan. Hatacho untano al gabeg gehalim. I took the Korban Pesach and I cut it. I didn't cut it into pieces because I'm not allowed to do that. I have to roast it whole. But I just made incisions in it, kind of like when you make for a hot dog, right? You just make a little incision so that it will cook better inside. So since it's not, since you're cooking it differently, you want to cook evenly. So you make just some small incisions and you put it directly on the coals. Is that considered sili esh? Amadabi omed? Omed anish? Is there sili esh? Yes, I think that's considered fine, right? Even though it's not from the flames of the fire, but from the heat of the coals, that's also called sili esh. All right, now we have a contradiction. Did the Bi really say that? We have another baraita that says as follows. This is regarding the laws of Sara'at. Sara'at translates leprosy. It's not necessarily leprosy, some kind of skin disease. And in some of the forms is if you see some of the signs of Sara'at on the skin that has a burn on it, michvat esh, right? If the skin has an inflammation, you want to know, did that inflammation come from a burn? And that will decide one of the definitions of sada'at. So what does it mean, michvat esh? En li ela shenichva ba'esh. I know for sure, if someone actually got burnt by fire, they put their arm in fire and they got burnt, that's for sure considered part of michvat esh. But what about other cases? How about nichva ba'gachelet? What if it's just a hot coal that's not actually burning on fire, but it still has heat in it, or ba'demetz, or burning ashes, besid roteach, lime, begipesis roteach, burning plaster, v'chol davar haba min ha'or, or anything else that comes from fire. So these are all things that are heated from fire, and so now you're getting residual heat or indirect heat from them, including other things that were like water that was heated by fire. And so someone gets burned by water and then they see sadat in that area. Is that called michvat esh, even though it's not directly esh? Talmud omar michva, michva riba. Later on, the pasuk says michva again. Another time it says burn. And by repeating michva, michva, this teaches that all types of burns, whether from fire directly or indirectly, are considered sada'at. All right, so how is this a contradiction? The only reason why we included indirect burns is because it says twice. But if not that it was twice, then we would not consider those indirect burns to be fire. So, right, you see, this is a problem for it to be, because it to be said, if I cook the Korban Pesach on coals, so this is not fire, it's just hot coals, and it's heating, it's roasting from that, he says that is called sili esh. But we just said, without the word michvah, something that's just hot coals or indirect fire is not considered fire. So which one is it? Here's the answer. Amar le gachelet shel aetz laistirich kera l'raboye, ki istirich kera le gachelet shel matechet. Oh, we're talking about two different types of coals. If you're talking about coals of wood, right? Wood that's boulder, that's smoldering. That for sure is fire. And we would know no matter what. And when the pasuk says michva michva twice, that comes to include burning hot metal, right? So I guess a usual fire is always with wood. So when the wood is burning, whether the fire is coming out of it or it's just very, very hot and you're cooking on it, that's all called fire. But hot metal, where there's no flames coming out of it, that's the case of gachelet that we need to include and would not be fire normally. All right, so that resolves the contradiction, but it raises new questions. So according to that, you said that, yeah, in the case of sarat, michva, michva, twice. So yeah, if you burn yourself on hot metal, for the case of sarat, it's called esh. But otherwise, it's not, hot metal is not considered esh. Is that true? והגבי בת כהן דכתיב באש תסרף, ועמד על מתנה, פתילה של אבד, היו עושים לה. One of the four, there's four ways of capital punishment, right? סקילה, סרפה, הרג וחנק. So סרפה applies in a, to a case of a בת כהן, a daughter of a כהן, if she commits adultery, she's engaged to someone and she's not faithful. So she gets a special punishment different from others that commit adultery. As the Torah says, ba'esh tisaref, she's burnt with fire. You know this from the story of Yehuda and Tamar. He says, you know, go burn her. So now the question is, how do we actually do that, right? And so we, Rav Matana taught that you take lead, right, molten lead, and pour it down her throat. I told you today's going to be a little more, even more gory than yesterday. But all right, we have to figure out, the Torah says this form of capital punishment, so we have to figure out what exactly it means. We're not going to do it, but exegetically. So there you go. Look, here it says, Ba'esh tisaref, you burn her with fire, and that means that you burn her with molten lead. Therefore, hot metal is considered fire, right? And this contradicts what you just said, because your answer was based on the fact that, yeah, wood coals are considered fire no matter what, but metal coals, you need the extra word mikvah. Otherwise, metal coals are not considered the definition of fire. But here it says fire, and you use hot metal to accomplish the task. So this is a problem. Shane hatam damar kira ba'esh tisaref. Tisaref labot kol serafot abot min ha'esh. No, in the case of the daughter of the Kohen, it says an extra word, ba'esh and tisaref. In fire, she shall be burned. So tisaref, especially in the passive form, that comes to include anything that has to do with fire, even if it's not directly fire. If it just said ba'esh, then it has to be in fire. Ba'esh tisaref, will be burned, comes to include even metal that you heat it up with fire. Okay, but that's why that's an exception. V'chol sheken esh esh asma. Okay, but now we have a question. Why did Rav Matana over here in the first place say that we, when it says to burn her, we use molten lead? For sure, it includes fire itself. Like, if you're gonna, you know, why just skip over the most obvious explanation? Right? Let's put bundles of branches around her and burn her. This reminds me of the Holy Grail scene, right, where they in Monty Python, when they find a witch and they say burn her. So why not follow the simple meaning of the pasuk and just actual burning with fire? Atya serefa serefa mi bnei Aharon. Ma lahalan serefat neshama veguf kayam. Afkan serefat neshama veguf kayam. When the sons of Aharon brought an unwarranted ketoret fire into the mishkan when during the dedication, and they died, just as they died with fire, but it doesn't say exactly. So the midrash learns that the fire was from inside, right? That they were not like burned from the outside, but rather it was a fire inside that killed them. But therefore, their sedefad neshama, their soul was burnt, but guf kayam, but their body remained intact. Even their clothing, it says there, was perfectly fine. In other words, even though they did something wrong and they deserved capital punishment, but it's disgraceful if their body also would look disfigured. So just like in that case, when they deserve capital punishment by fire, it means fire from inside and the body remains intact. So to hear Afkan Serifat Neshama Beguf Kayam regarding the Bat Kohen, we want to, should be a dignified type of capital punishment. I mean, look, even today when we have capital punishment, we still want it to be in at least the least gory possibility, even though we're actually killing someone. So that's the reason why we would not just throw her into a fire, but rather from the inside. Okay, v'nabid lachameh ha'ur. And now another question, why do you use molten lead? Why not boiling water? Okay, it's not clear here if they mean boiling water, pour it down her throat, that would still be the inside, or actually boil her in water, as horrible as that sounds. But the rabbis are just speaking theoretically here, right? This is, you know, what does this mean? Mishum de Rav Nachman, de Rav Nachman, amar kera v'abtadacha kamocha, beror lo mitayafa. Because we have to love our neighbor as ourselves, and our neighbor includes even a criminal who's guilty of capital punishment. And so mita yafa, even the death penalty has to be a death penalty that's as kind as possible. And so to boil a person would be excruciating, horrible pain. And so we would not even wish that on our worst enemies, who we have to also treat as much as possible like we would ourselves. And so that's why we do not boil the person. Instead, the best way of burning, of giving capital punishment by burning would be the molten lead. All right. Now, once you told me this this general principle that we should find the kindest type of death penalty, so why do I even need the Gezerah Shavah to learn from the sons of Aharon that just like they were burned from inside, so too, right? I would know this no matter what, that you wouldn't burn someone from the outside with either with fire, with branches or with water, because that's not mitai yafa. That's not a kind way to kill someone. So Amri, Ilav gezerah shavah mina serefat neshama veguf kayam, lav serefah hi. Oh no, if without the gezerah shavah, I would think that that type of burning from inside is not even called burning. And so I didn't fulfill what the Torah says, ba'esh tisaref. So that's why I need the gezerah shavah. Vimi shum Rav Nachman, nepush la chabile zemorot tuba, kechi detamut ba'agala. Kamashmalan. If you only had Rav Nachman, I would think, okay, it has to be a least painful death. So maybe I would say, make a very hot fire with lots of branches, and then she'll die relatively quickly. And so I might think that that's good enough. So therefore, I need both to teach that it should, that inside burning from inside is considered in fact burning, and that is therefore the most dignified way of performing capital punishment. Okay, ve'ela ba'esh lamali. So if you have all that, then why do you need the word ba'esh? Just say tisaref, burn. Why does it have to be with fire? Because we're not actually using fire at all, right? We're just using hot metal. The answer, lapuke avar me'ikaro. This is to exclude lead that came from its source already hot. Like, I don't know, maybe if you're living near a volcano and, you know, you have some lead that's or naturally hot, no, you can't use that. You have to take a regular lead, heat it up with fire, and that way you would be able to fulfill ba'esh and tisaref. All right, good. Amar le debi Yirmiyah le debi Zera, v'chol hecha dichti ba'esh tisaref, lerabot kol serefot haba'ot mechamat esh hu. So now that we established that when it says ba'esh and tisaref, as it says with bat kohen, that comes to include anything indirectly from fire also, right? That's what we just said, because we use the molten lead there, because it says ba'esh and tisaref. V'hagabe parim ha-nisrafim dichti behu v'saraf oto al esim ba'esh. V'tanya ba'esh v'lo besid roteach v'lo begipesis roteach. Well, we have a question on that, because there's another place where it has both of these words, esh and tisaref. And that is when you take a pad, a bowl, that is entirely burnt. This is for a chatat. Chatat offering that's for a, for let's say the Sanhedrin makes a mistake. So then they have to bring a bull. This is not for an individual that sins by mistake, but only for an official that does. So in that case, when you bring that bull, it all has to be burnt. And the pasuk says saraf, and it says aletzim ba'esh. So it has both of these words. And the braita says, since it says the word ba'esh, then we learn from that, not in burning lime and not in burning plaster, it has to be fire itself. So now we're wondering why? Why does it say that? Since it says saraf and ba'esh, and you just said saraf, when it says esh and saraf together, then that means any type, even indirect heat. So why not here also? Amale hachi hashta. Wait, are you comparing bat kohen to the case of the chatat that's a bull? Hatam ketish keti ba'esh, v'hadar tisaref. Regarding the Bat Kohen, first it says the word fire, and then it says shall be burnt. So you always go by the second term, right? Fire is like an example. Shall be burnt means from fire, but in any way. But here regarding the par, it says burn it in fire. So the last word is in fire. Remember the esh in. And that emphasizes it has to be specifically fire. This is similar to the rule we say klalu prat, you go by the prat. Prat uklal, you go by the klal. Anytime the Torah gives a formulation of a generality and then something particular, the what it really means is the last item that you mentioned. So to hear the formulations, even though both have both words, the formulations are different, and we're always going to go by the second word, and that's why besh tisaref. Tisaref means in any way, even indirect. All right, so that sounds good, except Hatam name ketiba serefa lebasof. Regarding the bull, at the end of the pasuk, it says again, serefa dichtib al shefech hadesh and yisaref, that the ashes that are left over from this korban hatat of the bull shall be burnt, right? And it says al shefech hadesh, where you burn the ashes, that's where you put the ashes that are left over from the mizbeach, you should also burn this korban hatat. So you see how it says esh, and then it ends with yisaref. Therefore, that should include all types of fire, even indirect. Now that yisaref we already used for a different halacha, that when we burn it, even if there is in fact no ashes in that spot, we would still burn this korban there. And yisaref even... If it was already mostly consumed on the Mizbeach, nevertheless, you still have to complete the burning process here. So since we use the word Yisaref for somewhere else, we end up just with Esh, and that's why for that Korban, it has to be fire itself and not things that were heated up from fire. Okay, all that was one answer for the contradiction, but let's remember where we are. The B is the one that said that if you roast the Korban Pesach directly on the coals, that's fine. That is called roasting. And so we had a contradiction from Sarat where it's not. And so we said, yeah, wood is considered fire, metal is not. And we brought a couple of contradictions from that, capital punishment and the bull solid sin offering. But now we're gonna have another answer altogether, right? So the contradiction from Sarat where it says michvah twice. And so we said, well, it says michvah twice to teach you that regarding Sarat, all types of fire, even indirect fire is fire, but otherwise it would not be fire. So Ravina is going to give a second answer to this. Okay, Ravina Amar, keroch utene michvat esh. So we can include two things actually in the first mention of michvat esh. Enli ela shenichva ba'esh u'bagachelet. If I had the first one, michvat esh, then I would know that if someone got a burn from fire or from wood or from regular wood coals, then that for sure would be called fire. Right, so he's already including the coals in within the first definition. How do I know all the other things that derive their heat from fire but are not fire itself? So the second michvah only comes to include all these other things. But if I had only one michvah, I would still know fire itself and I would know the coal. That coal is considered fire, and therefore that actually supports the Biuda Anasi, who says you can burn the Korban Pesach on coals. So that's Ravina's answer. Rava, however, Rameh. Mi amar Rabbi Gehalim ikeru esh? Did Rabbi really say that coals are called fire and you can burn the Korban Pesach on it? Uminhu gahale yachol omemot. Okay, now we're comparing it to another case of Yom Kippur. On Yom Kippur, the Kohen Gadol brings a pan full of burning coals, right? And he takes it from the Mizbeach and he brings it into the Kodesh Kodashim, and that's where he does the Ketoret. So he has to bring Gahale Esh. So now we're going to analyze this phrase, Gahale and Esh. Why does it say Gahale and Esh? Why not just say Gahalim? And I would know he brings some of the ashes from some of the burning wood, not ashes, some of the burning wood from the Mizbeach. What does ash come to include? So here we try to figure out what both mean. It's a compromise between them. So gahale, I would have thought omemot, even if it's just smoldering, a very, very low heat in the coals, like they're about to go out, would that be sufficient? No, that's why it says esh. If I had just esh, I would say, oh, maybe I could bring bring them while they're totally burning, while they have a flame on them? Why should I bring wood that has a flame on it? No, it has to be less than that. It has to be just coals. So it has to be just in between. Hakesad, maybe min halohashot. You bring ones from that are lohashot, really means whispering, right? They're just flickering. You can see they're red hot, but not that the flames are not up there. Alma gehalim la ikere esh. So you see, according to this, the word gehalim by itself does not mean fire. Amre. Now this whole thing seems to be itself a contradiction. So when you said that it means coals, and we wondered, does coals mean even if it's just barely, you know, smoldering? And so therefore we said, according to that, when it's lohashot, when they are flickering, that is called fire. So according to that, coals flickering is cold fire. Well, that's good for the bee. But the next part, emasefa, yesh yachol shal hevet, tamad omar gahale, alma afilu lo hashot lav eshninhu. But the second part we said, if it says fire, can it be that it's burning? That's why it says gahale. So it's flickering. So that way it's not fire. That means that the word esh does not apply to that which is flickering. So you see, this whole baraita is quite difficult in and of itself. And all this is a question on the B. So Rav Sheshat answers both this contradiction and he'll answer the question. V'amar Rav Sheshat, hachi katane, gahale yachol ben omemot ben lohashot. When it says gahale, the word gahale can include two definitions, whether it's a smoldering or smoldering, like very low, or flickering. Both of those are called a gahale. So can I bring either one? Tamud amar esh. No, it says esh, so therefore it has to be flickering. Yesh yachol shal hevet, but the word esh can also have two definitions. It can mean, you know, totally on fire. Tamud amar gahale. Therefore it says no coals, not a total fire. Hakesad mebi min alohasho. Therefore it has to be whispering, it has to be flickering hot. Mikom makom gehalim la ike so lohashot. Okay, so according to that, we have an answer that the word esh does in fact apply to flickering coals. So that's fine, even if there's no fire. Okay, but now further question. But these coals themselves are not actually called fire, only because we needed the word esh to tell me that it has to be on fire and not just gehalim. So it's still a question on the B. I have a better way to explain it. Gahale yachol omemot velo lochashot. Can it be that that means that smoldering and not flickering? Tamudomar esh. That's why it says fire, so it has to be flickering. If it says just fire, then that could mean, right here, see, Abaye's adding something that Rav Sheshat didn't, that esh could has actually it does have both definitions, that it could be totally fire, or just a gachelet without a fire. Tomod omar gachale hakesad mebi min halohashot. So that's why it says gachale and esh, that it has to be flickering. They all agree that the coal that the Kohen Gadol brings has to be flickering, not about to go out and not a whole fire. But the question is, how do they fit it into the words of the pasuk? And the ones before, the word esh did not apply by itself to something that's flickering. But in the opinion of Abaye, it does. Okay. Amar Rabba, Rasa gachelet yabi, Rasa shel hebet yabi. Rabba says, this last explanation, you said in the middle that just the word esh would mean that you can bring, if you had only the word esh, that you can bring either a coal or a fire itself. I have just a practical question on that. Shalhevet belo gachelet, hechi mashkach adla. How can you have fire without a coal? I can just bring fire without fuel that it's attached to. We answer, kigon deshafiel mana mishha. It could be that you just put oil on the top of a utensil and you light the oil on fire. And so there you have fire without coal. Ve'itele be'nura. So then you're bringing in just the fire by itself without coal. If it was that, I wouldn't need a pasuk, the word gahale, to say that you can't do that. I wouldn't bring that kind of fire even to a human being. It's not a dignified way to bring a fire. So I don't need a pasuk for that. So rather, that was Abaye finally, Rava is going to give yet another interpretation of the Pesukim. Ela marava taresachi. Gahale yachol omemot velo lo hashot. So far, it's the same. Right? When it says, if I had just said gahalim, then I would say, oh, can it be that it would be smoldering, but not flickering? Tamulamad esh. No, it needs a little bit more fire. Iesh yachol yavi mechesa gahalet mechesa shel hebet. If it just said fire, I would say, oh, maybe I could bring something that's half and half. In other words, when I take it from the mizbeach, it's on fire. But it's a low flame, like half is half not. And by the time I bring it to the Kodesh Kodashim, then the fire will die down. So I might think that that's okay, as long as once I get to the Kodesh Kodashim, the fire will not be visible. No, that would not be good, because Pasuk says, when I take it from the Mizbeach, has to be Gahale Esh. At that time, has to be only coals and not fire. Okay, so this resolves the question of his teacher, Rabba. All right, and with that, we answer the question that we had, the contradiction from Yom Kippur, right? That is true, even though, right, Rabbi said Gahalim, coals means roasted on coals. So coals means that it is in fact fire. And we saw a contradiction this just now from Yom Kippur, where he has to bring Gehalim, Gehale Esh. And over there, where we had a whole thing, what does those words mean? But in the end, we saw that the word Esh can over there mean coals that are flickering, and that would be just fine. So too, Rabbi says it's fine. All right, last question, and then we'll read the Mishnah also today. When we said these coals are flickering, as if with an aleph or an ayin, apparently they didn't distinguish in their pronunciation, so they weren't sure how to spell this word. Pasuk in Yechezkel said, it's talking about the king that's so great, comparing them to trees, and this king is so great that the other cedar trees cannot even compare to it. So lo amamuhu. At their understanding, amu is like could not even singe it, right? They couldn't even make it hot at all and or harm it. So you see, it's spelled with an ayin. So too over here it should be spelled with an ayin. All right, so that's finishes the discussion of fire. Next Mishnah is going to talk about a lot of actually very relevant cases to the laws of kashrut, when something kosher and non-kosher touch each other. What do we do? Naga beharso shel tanur. So you have the korban pesach on a spit, right? That's fine, and it's going rolling around, and it's going to be getting cooked from the fire itself. But also you put it in an enclosure inside an oven so that the heat will build up. That's totally fine. The problem is, what if by mistake you shift it around and the Korban Pesach touches the side of the oven? And in that case, it's being heated not directly from the fire, but indirectly from the heat that's the wall of the oven. And that's not permitted, because it's not Siliesh. What do you do in that case? Yiklofet mikomo. So you just have to peel off just that spot, wherever it touched the side of the oven, peel that off and throw and don't eat it. But the rest of the korban is kosher. Nataf merotebo ala cheres vechazar elav yitol mekomo. What if some of the gravy from the Pesach fell onto the wall of the oven and then got heated up over there and then splattered back onto the korban Pesach? Now that area is boiled, not from the fire, right, but from the heat of the liquid. And so that's not permitted either. In that case, you have to take more than just a peel, right, because that gravy will cook a whole chunk. So you have to take off an entire layer of the korban, but the rest of it is fine. Nataf medot bo ala solet ikmos et mekomo. If you had some flour also cooking in there, and some of the gravy falls onto the flour, and then the flour is hot, and now the flour is going to make that gravy hot, but the gravy is korban pesach, and which has to be heated only by siliesh, not by flour. So ikmos et mekomo, you have to take that handful of flour from his place, and that you have to destroy, but the rest of it is kosher and you can eat. Sacho b'shemen teruma. Let's say you took this korban pesach and you put oil all around it. Sounds delicious, But this oil is tiruma, so only a kohen can eat it. So im chaburat kohanim yochelu. If everybody in the group are kohanim, that's fine. They can eat. They're allowed to eat tiruma. Im shel Yisrael, im chay hu yedichenu. If it's Yisrael, and then someone put tiruma oil on it, so if it's still raw, then wash it off. You can wash off the oil, and then you can cook the rest of it. Im salihu yikolof et hachison. If it's already cooked, then it already enters into the outer layer of the meat. And so then you have to peel off the outer layer, and the rest of it you can eat. Sacho ba'shemen shel ma'aseh sheni, lo ya'asenu damim al b'nei chabura, shen podin ma'aseh sheni b'irushalayim. Rather than turuma, you took oil that was ma'aseh sheni. That's when everyone has to bring that tenth to Yerushalayim, and we can all enjoy it and eat it. So it's fine, even for Yisrael. But Maaseh Sheni, while you can enjoy it and share it, you can't sell it to others. So if you're the one that brought your Maaseh Sheni, in normal cases, when you're sharing Korban Pesach, you will split the cost. But the cost of that oil that was Maaseh Sheni, you can't sell. So therefore, the rest of the people do not pay for it, because you cannot redeem or sell Maaseh Sheni when you're already in Yerushalayim, because when you're in Yerushalayim, then you have to sell it. All right, we'll see tomorrow a lot of very, very practical applications of this, which can happen when something kosher or not kosher touch each other. Let's say they're dry foods, then that halacha is the same here, that you just have to slice off a piece from the area where it touched, but the rest of it, the rest of the meat or whatever it is, would be kasher. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.